This is Chris Massima with Best Life Psychology. Today I am with Terrence Ganaway, big time running back at Baylor University. We actually went to Baylor at the same time, didn't know it at the time, but he holds the single season rushing record for yards and single season rushing record for touchdowns. He was drafted by the Jets in the sixth round in 2012 and had a career with the Rams as well. He now is an overall awesome family guy, lives in the DFW area, and we're here to talk about athlete mental health. So, Terrence, thank you for being here. I really appreciate you taking the time, honestly, to talk about something that I feel like is not neglected per se, but maybe not pursued as much as it should be. So let's jump right in. Could you share with us a little bit about your story, what it was like growing up for you?
Yeah, I mean, I appreciate you having me on. I know this has been in the works for a while, but it's just an awesome opportunity to just talk about life and the realm of athletics and what athletes go through. But it's also a huge day for us as Baylor Bear fans, as Baylor gets ready for
tomorrow. Yeah, Matt Rhule.
Big 12 game, and I think Baylor's going to win 45-20. So you heard it here first.
Oh, no.
You
I
don't
wish.
Think so?
Not 45-20. I don't even know if we're going to win.
Yeah. No, we're going to win tomorrow.
Okay.
Yeah, all right. It's,
you're bigger than me, so I'll let you have it.
No, it's a non-issue.
Yeah.
We're gonna take care of business, and just don't play this until after the game. Because if Oklahoma gets hold of it, then they can use it as ammo, and I don't want that.
Oh, it won't be ready, so okay. We'll be fine. Yeah, no bulletin board.
So we're good. Yeah, so, I mean, appreciate you having me on, and thank you for, you know, all you do and your work for this this cause. You know, I grew up small town, you know, probably about the size of this room, and imagine how big I am, and I'm, you know, one of my brothers. I have 8 brothers and 2 sisters. And so we just grew up in a small town, loving on each other, not a lot of money, not a lot of resources, but we did have each other. We focused on, you know, taking care of each other, family first, and doing some things that really, you know, helped position me to make a lot of decisions later on in life. My dad was a pastor, also worked, jobs to just put food on the table.
Yeah.
Me and my wife have 4 kids. I can't imagine having 6, 7, yeah, 8 more kids than that. But they put up with us all, and man, it was fun. And in that growing up, what I've learned from psychology and as far as the mind is the first kid in the family usually is the most mature, and then after that, what happens is that first kid raises the second kid, which the second kid raises the third kid. But whenever there's a gap of about 4 years, it's like it starts over again. Mm-hmm. And so between me and my older brother, there's a 4-year gap. And so when it comes to listening and understanding and being molding of people, I naturally had to do that growing up because I had older brothers and sisters that I looked up to and I talked to, but we just wasn't living in the same space at the same time.
Right. So would you say you had to become early on more autonomous, more independent?
For sure.
Your thinking?
Okay. For sure. I had to. And then I had to take care of, my dad worked night shift sometimes, and my mom drove a diesel trailer, so she was gone, especially in my formative years in high school. So I had to really raise my younger brother and sister. They're only a year younger than me. They're twins.
Right.
But I had to do a lot of things to set them up to make sure that they were good to go, getting them to school, workouts, and if there was anything that needed to be done that my parents couldn't do, making sure that I was present and stuff like that. So really just trying to impart and give them as much of me as I could. So naturally, I just became a giver, and I think that's just who I was born to be. It didn't happen my freshman, sophomore year in high school, but I had to do some things and grow up and be a lot more mature than my older brothers had to do. I had to advance a lot faster in my learning and what I was going through at the time.
So basically, this differential between chronological age, which there wasn't a huge gap between you and your younger siblings that you helped take care of, but a much larger gap with the psychological maturity age.
Yeah, for sure.
Okay.
For sure. I mean, you think about it, you know, most people that have a huge gap in their family, they're close, But if you're 10 years older than me, you have kids, and I'm just not going to college, like, your problems are not my problems.
It's a season of life issue. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you're not even speaking the same language at that point.
And so, but when I finally have kids 7 years later, I'm 25, have kids, now we can have some commonality. And still then, they're raising teenagers probably by that time, and you're trying to figure out how to change a diaper without getting pissed on. And so, I mean, that's just the reality of it.
Yeah.
But, you know, grew up very, very poor, but had everything as far as love, commitment, family. But we had to go to work.
Yeah.
You know, I remember, you know, coming home and there was eviction notices on the door because, you know, we had to pay rent, we had to pay our mortgage.
Right.
Or coming home and there wasn't food on the table and we had to eat ketchup sandwiches or peanut butter, saltine crackers with peanut butter. I mean,
and that one sounds better.
Yeah, well, it does sound better until you think about swallowing it. You try to swallow peanut butter, it's hard to swallow peanut butter, and then you try to swallow a solid saltine cracker.
Yeah, that makes sense, yeah.
Yeah, it's very hard to swallow.
Still sounds better than the ketchup option.
Yeah, the ketchup sandwiches. I don't eat much ketchup at all now, and I don't put it on any
sandwich. There's an aversion to it,
Oh, for sure. Then in mayo, we had a lot of BLTs growing up. I'm done. I'm just over those two condiments. I could care less if anyone ever makes them again.
Yeah.
But there's neither here nor there.
So you had to learn. You had to learn skills. You had to learn different things at. So the skills that you were learning weren't age-related skills. Mm-hmm. They were things that typically an average person would learn later on in life in terms of life skills, right? But you were starting to master those things earlier on. Do you think that had, just to jump a little bit ahead and we'll come right back, do you think that had an impact on you as a player having to learn to master life earlier?
Yeah, so my strengths are... I'm process-oriented. Right. I'm idealistic, so I'm always thinking about ideas. I'm futuristic. I'm always thinking about the future. And I'm individualistic, meaning I think for others and their future as well. So if you put all that together, those are, you know, four of my top five traits. Mm-hmm. And then competitiveness is up there, obviously.
Yeah.
But so when I think about that, I tell my wife all the time, I've always wanted kids since I could say the word kids. You know, I grew up with a huge family. I remember watching those Feed the Families, Feed the Kids across the, you know, seas over and over again. I always tell my mom, hey, I want to adopt a kid. And she's like, go in there and play with one of your siblings.
Go get a kid.
Yeah, you're like, don't, we're not doing any of that. And so I just was always fond of building people up and building myself up. And I'm very, very reflective. You know, and so I think I'm harder on myself than anyone else is. And I respect when I do have criticism, whether it's good or bad criticism, I think we can learn from it. But yes, early on, I was working through mental pathways to set me up in life because I knew what I wanted to do because I thought about the future. And I think most of the time when people don't think about the future, now God always says, don't worry about tomorrow. I'll take care of tomorrow. But you have to plan for tomorrow. Or else you're the guy that had the talent that put it in the ground and didn't plan for anything.
Right.
The other two planned for God to come back and say, hey, what did you do with it? So they went to work. And so what I did is I went to work. I went to work mentally, and I had a good group of people around me as far as friends. And I think I'm truly fortunate and truly blessed to have that small circle of friends that I grew up with that were in my class growing up. But I knew where I wanted to go. Then all I had to do is figure out and calculate a plan of action. And once I knew football was that opportunity, I went to work really hard in football, and it gave me an opportunity to go play at Houston by way, then came to Baylor and had opportunity after college. But
instead of a few records along the way.
Yeah, well, you know,
it's okay.
So
it's okay.
Records are, especially if it was tennis, and I'm setting records in tennis, I'm like, I'm the best tennis player in my time at this time.
But because the offensive line,
yeah,
team,
I mean, there's so many things that go into, you know, being a great running back.
Right.
And so I was honored as a Baylor legend a few weeks ago, and I'm just thinking this is one of the most selfish awards ever because I played on teams that those are guys that would never get mentioned. Mm-hmm. They may not ever be a Baylor legend. But the reason why I had success
is because they did their job.
Yeah. And, you know, I remember in, you know, film room at the games, Glasgow Martin and I would run the exact same play, and I'll get 20 yards, and he'll get stopped for 2 yards. And he's like, how do you understand that? I was like, man, it's just, you know, luck of the draw. And so over time, you just, you know, I was talking to a friend the other day, you just get lucky enough and then things work in your favor.
So humble.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm very fortunate to play on a good team. Yeah. You know, going back to, you know, having, you know, grew up poor and grew up fighting for things and wanting a better life and seeing it in the future, I always had a plan, and football was it. Until, you know, my freshman year, they said that I would never play football again because I had a leak in my aortic valve. And so I was scared to death. My parents were scared to death. And we went to, you know, doctor in Little Rock, Arkansas. And they said, hey, you can't play football anymore. You can't lift. But small town where everything shuts down and you play football on Saturday, you know, Friday nights. Everybody's at the game. There's a doctor there that could release me, so I was able to play on Saturday, on Fridays, and
then Friday night light stuff.
Oh yeah, for sure. But you know, long story short, is that afforded me the opportunity to learn a little bit more about healthcare, and I was passionate about going into healthcare because my experience with it, and then my mom got sick and died of cancer. And so a lot of life happened from not going to play football ever again to having the opportunity to continue to play and, you know, then going on to play in the NFL, mom passing away, grandmother passing away, and just having a lot of stuff that happened while I was in college. And like I said, I had older brothers and sisters. None of them had ever went and finished college. And so I didn't have a lot of, you know, beacon points to, like, you know,
throw lighthouses.
Yeah, no, throw a dart at and say, hey, this is where I want to go. And so when I went to Houston, my mom passed away. I left school because I didn't know anything else. I just thought when things get hard, I got to go back home because this is what everyone else does. But I really had a good friend in, you know, Brian Berry, who became my mentor, who danced with me and my wife as we got married, him and his wife did, and really just put a lot of, and instill a lot of wisdom and a lot of things in me to help me get over some hurdles that we are a part of as our culture and our experiences and the atmosphere we grew up in. It allowed me to learn a lot. And then obviously I had the best education and best time ever at Baylor University, which I think I'm still reaping the benefits of it because, you know, I can walk some places and, you know, people say, oh, you're that guy. And I'm in their doors and I can talk to people and I can get in front of people just because of my opportunity at Baylor. But I think as athletes, what we tend to do, and I was arguing with my brother about this last night, we tend to be selfish about it.
Right.
Like, I got here because of what I did.
Right.
You know, I worked hard like everything depended on me, but I prayed like everything depended on God. And that's a great scenario when you are doing both of each. You got to work hard regardless. And that's what God asks us to. That's why he gives us, you know, a lot of talents to go out and fulfill his purpose. But he also understands that you can't work harder than what I can bless you. And so you have to be humble enough to accept grace and allow humility to come in to take over so that he can place you and put you in places that that you couldn't go yourself. So
what was the argument then? Was he against that?
Well, we were talking about, he, you know, me and my brother arguing all the time, but we're talking brothers. About how, yeah, you know, some people shouldn't do professions because, you know, it takes them away from God. And I was like, I agree. There are some things that take you further away from God, but why would God bless people with talents and abilities to do things?
To do those things.
If it wasn't to honor him.
Right.
I said, one of the, you know, the biggest professions out there that are all self-seeking is scientists, like, and doctors and stuff like that, because they go in there and they think they're God. Like, hey, I've fixed you. I got you back up working. And God blessed them with the ability to use their hands, their minds, and the tools to help save life or extend life and stuff like that. But ultimately, God breathes life in us. And so I was telling him that's the big part of what athletes have to, you know, realize is that we honor him in all that we do. And then on the end of it, we just say, hey, you know, I appreciate all the hard work, but I need more from you.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's just, you know, one of those things I look at now and see. But it's tough. It's tough being an athlete in the world today, especially with the presence of social media. I wouldn't say it's the movement, but the presence of social media and everyone having a voice.
Yeah, just this is kind of left field, but I don't know if you saw what happened to the Penn State quarterback when they lost to, was it, who did they lose to? Like 3 or 4 weeks ago.
Minnesota?
Was it Minnesota? Yeah. When they lost to Minnesota, he had death threats all over social media, and he had to shut down his Twitter. Like, that's ridiculous. But now people have access to that. They have the ability to have their voices.
Yeah.
We'll put quotes around that. Their voices be heard in such a negative way. And you can't tell me that doesn't impact somebody's life. Of course it does.
My grandmother used to always say, when me and my brothers and everyone and just get in an argument, if you don't have anything nice to say, don't say it.
It's funny how those simple old-time philosophies still hold true.
Just don't say anything.
Don't say anything.
Like, first of all, you're not going to feel better.
You're going to feel better, but you don't.
If something happens to that person.
Right.
But you're definitely not making them feel better. And I think we need social media could be a tool to bring about great things, which it does. What's amplified is all the noise in the background.
Yeah. You could make the argument, well, now my huddle film gets viewed more, right? Absolutely.
Yeah.
I like to look at social media very much like I look at casinos. I don't look at casinos and say that they're inherently evil or bad. I look at somebody with a bad heart or roots of problems who is entering a place where those roots and those hearts become exacerbated because they're in the wrong area, right? So you have roots and you have fruits. And if your roots are ruined, you're going to reach for the wrong fruits.
Yeah.
And so they reach for money through the casino, or they reach through something through social media, like venting towards the quarterback at Penn State, when really that's a root issue.
Yeah.
And it's obvious for some of us, but it's not obvious for the person who's doing it.
Yeah.
And it's sad. It's really sad.
It's a low margin error for athletes now.
Yeah.
Because not only are you expected to play up to ungodly expectations, but you're supposed to live up to it also off the field.
Oh, you can't voice your opinion.
Oh,
don't get into politics. Yeah. Like, you're an athlete.
You know, I like Charles Barkley, and he says, I'm not a role model. You know, you can find somebody else to be a role model for your kids.
Right.
I get what he's saying. I went to school. While I was at school, everyone thought, oh, Terrence is a Christian guy, blah, blah, blah. It was before I even got on campus.
Right.
That was just what other people were saying, and it kind of just, you know, naturally grew. And so I had to do things certain ways, and it made me live a dark lifestyle, if I'm being honest, a dark lifestyle where everyone saw me, but when I got home, I did different things because I needed to break free from the stigma.
From being on.
Yeah.
Because you had to be on, And it's like a performance.
I know a very talented female athlete that played at Baylor that went through the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
And we used to talk about it all the time. It's just these unrealistic expectations of what we're supposed to live like. And we struggle with things because we're human.
Well, I was about to say, you're not supposed to be human if you're an athlete.
Yeah. And we're vulnerable. And I mean, you think about, you're going to work and doing this all day.
Right.
And you got a big thing that's on TV, 50,000 people watching, you know, like, man, Chris sucks at his job. And, like, next week you go prepare, you spend all week preparing, Chris sucks. Like, after a while, you're like, I don't want to hear that. And so, you know, when someone asks you, like, hey, what do you think happened today? You snap at them, and you're like, well, I mean.
You project out. It's all a giant cycle. We think that they're separate. We the phrase I hear a lot is, you're an athlete, go be an athlete. But what does that mean? I don't understand what that means. Yeah. So am I nothing else? Yeah. Is that all that I do? Is that all that I am? I put on a uniform, and then when I can no longer put on the uniform, I'm not Chris anymore?
Yeah.
Go be an athlete. That's your job. Go do your job. It's like, no, my job is to be human.
Yeah.
Because that's, like you said, I've been given a set of strengths. I've been getting, but that means not just the physical, it means the mental, the way that I perceive things, the benefits I can bring to people's lives. And you can't fully portray those and give those out to the world unless you're vocal.
Mm-hmm.
You can't help from being silent.
Yep.
You have to go out there and make your voice be heard. It's a catch-22 that athletes find themselves in today. It's a very, I don't know if I'd call it rocky so much as confusing road that athletes have to navigate now. And with all the money involved in it, people are taking advantage of them left and right, and friends are taking advantage of them. And all that is to say, I actually created a model. I wanted to touch on this briefly. You actually lined it up for me to hit it out of the park nicely. It's called RAMP, and it's designed to be a preventative care, but it can be in real time, model for athletes. It was originally designed for athletes. I also use it with esports, families, and a bunch of other things. But it was originally designed for athletes to kind of be used as bumper lanes for their lives. Mm-hmm. Because the navigation today is so confusing for athletes, having some type of framework for them and their families to not necessarily hit home runs and or strikes every time, but to make sure they're always hitting at least a pin as they work towards a specific goal. That's why I created it, okay? And so as you were describing your childhood, it really hit me hard. You had, there's three types of relationships. Relationship with self, others, and the world. Because of your childhood and how many siblings you had, that was kind of turned upside down in a way that I think benefited you in the long run. Your relationships with others, your siblings, was way different than the average relationship with siblings. Yeah. Which in turn influenced your relationship with self. You became more autonomous, probably more outspoken. You started working earlier than other people, which influenced A, autonomy. You became a very independent person early on, which you have to be to succeed in anything you do. Because you became very autonomous early on, you sought out ways to be more skillful in that role in your family, which is mastery. Yeah. And you did all those things to facilitate your life's purpose, which is P. And I think you were actually doing ramp, and we haven't talked about this beforehand. I think you were doing ramp without knowing you were doing ramp.
Yeah.
And I think it shows. I think your approach, your humbleness shows in your success. I think it shows in the way that you've influenced me. I like to say, you know, TG is an all-around good guy. I like to say that. TG is an all-around good guy. And I think that's the best way to describe you. It's not as an athlete, it's an all-around good guy. But it's amazing how your story, for me, and this is just me speaking out loud, really aligned with what I'm hoping will become something that is more mainstream to help make things easier for families and athletes to navigate what is now a very confusing multitude of streams yeah. that they have to get through between high school, college, and potentially the NFL ranks.
Yeah, I mean, it's a low margin of error now. With social media and the presence of it, there's pressures there. Not only is there pressures there, but there can be pressures at home.
Yeah, tons.
And they start early. Me and my wife go back and forth. I don't want my kids involved in anything. And then early on, because I just think there's a lot of expectations of how they should play and how they should perform, that kind of, as a kid, kids are like wildflowers. You just plant them and they grow wherever. But the world tells you have to like grow in this little, you know, 2x2 box. Mm-hmm. And you only can have one stem, but kids are creative, imaginative, and they're just awesome.
Right.
And we slowly just chip them down until they're like this, you know, zombie walking.
Yeah.
And I tell them, I just want my kids to be kids. And when they get older, I don't even know if they'll play football. If they want to, they can. But I'm going to call Joey, the tennis coach, women's tennis coach, and I want all four of my kids to play tennis.
Yeah.
For one, you can play until you're 60.
True.
And then there's just a lot of unused scholarships for American female tennis players.
Right.
And so, and my sons can help them get better. It's all going to work out, I think.
Yeah.
And I think me and my wife are talented enough to help them learn a skill later on in life at 10, 11, and 12 versus 4, 5, and 6, and then still give a lot back to them. But there's a lot of pressure for these young kids to succeed. So what you see is there's a physiological response to stress. So when I'm stressed, I get more tense. When you're more tense, usually you tear stuff. And when you can see it now, more younger athletes are tearing ACLs, you know, breaking bones because right. they're stressed some way or somehow. And what I usually tell you know, parents of kids in high school, they're like, well, you did this, what would you do? I was like, just let them have fun. Like, stop putting pressure on them. If they don't want to work out at 5 a.m. every day, like, let them be a kid. Because once you get to that level, and there's people that do it, and, you know, that's all fine and dandy, but you got to alleviate a lot of stress off of young kids, because I think from the ages of 12, middle school to high school,
mm-hmm.
kids are marketed to, they're sold to
yes.
more than any group on the world. And it's all these different things that a lot of times are different than what the home environment is teaching. And so they're at school 8 hours a day, then they go to practice for 2 or 3 hours, and they get 30 minutes at night with the parents, they're not having these conversations. They're not
they don't even want to have those conversations.
Yeah, because they're done. They're stressed out. They're tight. They're tense. They don't, and they, you know, people are always like, I don't know why my 13-year-old is snapping at me. He never snapped at me. Because he's doing too much. He's overworked. He's overloaded. He or she is overloaded. And so what we do, we let our kids live in this bubble, and we to help them manage their emotions, we just create a bubble that we manage it for them. Like, right. Oh, he can't do that. We don't even want to mention that. You know, when you and I were growing up, if I had a, you know, me and Joe just didn't get along, we had a fight, we're frustrated, and then we're done with it.
Yeah. So basically what you're saying is, because one of my questions was going to be, what would be your advice be to parents?
Yeah.
Basically what you're saying is, please stop stripping them of their autonomy.
Yeah. You got to let them experience emotions. Right. The reason why we are in such a disarray across multiple enterprises and businesses and cultures is because no one knows how to manage anything. No one knows how to be sad.
Yeah.
No one knows how to be depressed.
And that it's okay to be those things at times.
Yeah.
And that you'll get through them faster if you've had a practice with them. I like to say, just like my model, parents should be like bumper lanes.
Yeah.
It's okay if your kid hits a pin.
Yeah.
Just don't let them gutter. Don't let them get into cocaine.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. If they get into cocaine, we got to hit the emergency button. Yeah. But getting a C is not the end of the world. Sit your child down, have a conversation with them, ask them what's going on, converse with them, but don't hit the panic button. So I got a 97 one time on a physics overall grade, and my mom just got so angry, she hit the table. She's like, why isn't it a 98? Because it would have been a 5.0. That's one of those examples. Yeah. Like, it's just not necessary.
Well, the kids are marketed to, because marketing has listened to what kids want.
Right. Oh, they know. Or what they know that they want to need.
Yeah, yeah.
They convince you that you want to. Yeah.
So, but parents, they've taken the role of parents. So parents are not listening to their kids.
They're not.
And so they don't understand what they want. And, you know, I argument yesterday I had with my brother.
Yeah.
And I said, in sales, we got this thing, you know, that you just sometimes need to shut up.
Yeah.
When you're doing a deal, just shut up. The person who speaks first loses. So kids are dumb. They're just dumb. They don't know anything. They know what their world is, but in the big scheme of things, living life, and they're ignorant to it. So what kids will do, if you give them an opportunity, they will always tell you more than what they want to tell you. And then as a parent, your first thought is not to jump down their throat, but continue to listen, because then you break in barriers. Now they're talking to you, because you jump down your throat and they slipped up.
Sure.
They're like, okay, I can't go back there again. So now as an athlete, and you're going through all these things, and you snapping, and you're like, all right, let me just listen to this guy. And then when it's time, you got to open up, and you got to have discernment when to interject. You know, you don't let them go off on a tangent and then start slapping everyone in the house.
You reel them in. You're bumper
lanes.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it's so unfortunate, because kids are not heard, they're underheard, they're misunderstood.
Which hurts the relationship. Yeah. Then they're not autonomous because they can't speak for themselves. They're not learning the skills of communication because you're not letting them communicate. And they don't know what their purpose is because you're telling them what their purpose is.
And they're not confident.
Yeah.
And so
I could not agree more.
You're not going to do anything great without having any confidence.
Yeah.
You know.
But how do you build that? You build that through successful repetitions, right? But you have to see, I like to say, I've done this example a million times. What's going to happen if I drop this pencil?
It's going to fall.
It's going to fall. Yeah. How many times out of 100?
100.
How do you know that?
Gravity.
Over how time. Do you know repetition. Gravity? You've never seen, have no example in your psyche of it doing anything else than that. So if 9 out of 10 times I see myself succeeding something on my own, I'm going to believe in myself more that the 10th time I try it, I'll be successful at it. It's really not rocket science. Yeah. It's conditioning.
Yeah, it is. You know, asterisk to that point is, there's also a false sense of security and success. Because people will fail up in the success, and they think it's repeatable.
Yeah.
And so they'll 1 out of 1, they're 100%. But they'll keep doing it thinking that they've hit the jackpot or they struck gold. And 1 out of 10, there are 10% success rate for this. And so how do we get people to, you know, not be that? You know, or I can smoke, you know, marijuana before the game and go out there and play the best game of my life. And like, well, I'm coincidence. Athletes always like, I need to smoke another, you know, joint before the next game. Then I play the worst game. Oh, it's just, you know, other factors. And so there's a lot of influences, a lot of things that, you know, go into what success is. And is success really real, or is it just something that we experience?
A lot of great questions. Wish we could cover them all, especially the weed one. I'd love to have a conversation about that in terms of athletes. But do you mind if we transition a little bit to... Okay, so let's... If you don't mind, my next question is, because you've actually unintentionally answered some of the ones that I had for you, so thank you for that. Make my job easier. But do you feel that preventative care systems with mental health professionals kind of coming in and either being omnipresent where they're on staff or providing some type of system for the coaches and players and families and then leaving so that they can be self-sufficient, do you think those things are worth the money? And if you do, why aren't more high schools and colleges and professional teams and making the investment?
And you know, I think it's the time of the day. You only have 24 hours in a day. You got classes from, you working out from 6 to 8, classes from 8 to 1, film room at 2, practice, and then you're studying, and then next thing you know, you're asleep. So you only can make space what you have time for. So you have to carve out some space. And absolutely, I think it's 100% worth the money. And that's why there's, you know, player personnel people, and they're talking. I think it's more on an individual basis. Like Chris, you're there for a sounding board, but you don't have like a model. You don't have anything to help you, you know, evaluate players. But in sports science, I can wear some monitors, and I can work out every day of the week. I drop on Wednesday. My coaches will come to me and say, hey, something's not right today. Were you hurt? Were you tight today? What was going on? Did you tweak something on Tuesday late in practice? They can do that. But we don't have a model to show us, like, all right, I'm at work every day, I'm focused, I'm sharp, and then on Wednesday, I'm just, like, spashed out. Okay, what model can we use?
My model. That's what I want it to be. And here's my argument for that, because I hear this all the time. Because I work with athletes who are currently playing at D1 programs, and most of our sessions are done on Sundays because they're coming off of a game and they get to rest. And they'll go through their schedule. And I know it's ridiculous in college. High school, too, and NFL, obviously. But most of those guys are in college right now. So I know the schedule is insane. Here's why that doesn't work, though. Because every sport has an off season. Mm-hmm. So I've thought about that. The main struggles I see are finances for high schools. Mm-hmm. Not time for them. Finances are not a problem for college and pros, though. Those primary barriers are time. But every school has an off-season program. So that's why it's really difficult to have somebody on staff. So I created Ramp in part where you can't tell me you don't have the money and you can't tell me you don't have the time during off-season for me to come in for 6 to 8 weeks, teach your coaching staff this model, a way to create shared language amongst the coaching staff and shared language amongst the players, where they can all actively engage with each other in a cultural system of shared language with their mental health and performance. You get to streamline between different personnel coaches, different seasons of life, different age groups. You can streamline talking the same verbiage. When I come to you and say, hey, it's Wednesday and my A is just not there, you know exactly what that means. Well, when my A is not there, here's what I do. And you have, then you from there, which we can't get into today, you have a toolbox of things you can use for each of those pillars that have been taught to the coach and staff and therefore taught to the players. And now they can become self-sufficient without having to have somebody on staff 24/7, especially during the season.
Yeah.
And I'm a huge proponent and advocate of the fact that if you take care of the other 6 days, on seventh day when you perform, you perform better.
Yeah.
See, a lot of sports psychology is concerned with the free throw, the moment when you take the shot, kick the field goal, whatever it is. They forget that the other 6 days dictate that 1 hour in a lot of ways. My field goal kick is going to be less accurate if my girlfriend broke up with me 5 hours earlier.
Yeah.
And I don't have a hang of that, right? Which is par.
Yeah.
If you don't take care of those things during the week, it bleeds into game time. But we've just neglected that in its entirety. I really don't know what a good excuse is for people not to make the investment. The only thing I can think of, TG, and let me know if you think this is right, I think some coaches, maybe not intentionally, but they don't want there to be problems. Like, they don't want players engaging amongst each other about problems.
I don't believe that. At least it hasn't been my experience.
Okay.
With coaches.
Yeah.
I think coaches are there for you. But also coaches have talked about mental toughness since the beginning of athletics.
Right.
You know, sports. Like, you're not mentally tough enough. If you cry, then he's a soft kid. You can't get enough out of him. You can't yell at him. And over time, what we've learned is that people are coached differently. So different strokes for different folks. And I think while I was at Baylor, and I know, you know, Matt Rule and his staff are doing the same thing, is they really take time to invest in the players. Now, there's some coaches that invest in the players and they love the players. And there's some players that go play for a coach and it's like, I hated my time there, but we won, you know, a lot of games and I played in the NFL, but I don't care for the coach. I still respect, you know, the coach I played for. Everyone I know still respects him. And so I think early adoption is one. And as more athletes become more transparent, you know, more professional athletes become more transparent with, you know, their feelings, their emotions, I think it opens up a gateway for people like you to bring in a model to help support that, because everyone's going through, you know, I'm talking about suicide.
No, no, no.
Suicide is, you know, from 12 to 18, it's a high number of kids that have that pressure that they can't live up to a height. And it only continues, and however you cope with it, you know, it's not like when, you know, someone's a freshman in college, they're going to try drugs for the first time. They probably already experienced it and experienced with it. And so it became a catalyst for who they are. And then it blows up overnight. You know, they're caught doing something. Like, when did they start? When we never saw the signs. Well, there was a lot of signs. We just chose to ignore them. But there is, with mental health, man, without question, there is a need for us to focus, especially with athletic departments, which are money-making machines.
Oh, I don't, yeah. Again, we're not going to get into the paying, but so, man, so much money.
I don't think coaches can do it, though.
Yeah.
And I'm not giving them an out. I think coaches need to be better people persons, but I don't think they have the time to do it. Their job is to make sure the guys are physically fit and ready to play football. That's why they hire athletic, you know, counselors and, you know, academic counselors, so, and tutors, so someone else can teach. Now, I do think there need to be a subset of life skills where guys are learning life skills. You should know how. You know, Jack Ma is the guy over Alibaba. It's like Amazon and, you know, Asia. And he said, what we need to start teaching kids is soft people skills, how to be nice, how to respect. Because once you understand that, you give of yourself, you gain a lot of it back. And I like one of my favorite quotes right now is Anne Frank. No one has ever become poor by giving. And what we need to do, we need to find a way to give athletes a lot of resources and tools to understand how to act. When you're frustrated, when you're sad, when you're depressed, when you're elated, excited, because it's not, you know, they don't always, you know, do something because they're frustrated. They're like, hey, we just won a big game. Let's go snort coke.
Let's go burn some couches in West Virginia.
Well, that's the only thing you can do there. I mean, if you do that, you burn down those, you know, trees in the foothills and stuff.
Two true Baylor Bears.
Yeah. But there's a lot of things that athletes can benefit from if they had a model to understand how to manage the expectations of society.
Yeah, and also their families.
Yeah.
Because like you said, it starts super early.
Yeah.
It starts super early. If you can get the family on board with the exact same thing and you can learn early on how to have this conversation through the same framework for 10 years, it's a lot easier to continue that conversation later on. I mean, really appreciate you coming on. The last thing I will ask you about, and this is more of a personal thing, what are your thoughts on Coach Rule? Do you think he's going to stay? Do you think the success is going to continue? Do you think it's fool's gold? What do you think?
You know, I would say he overachieved this year.
Okay.
Naturally, I just want to say he overachieved. But when you look at it, you won 11 games. I think overachieving would probably win 9 games. And they're spotty here and there. You know, the first few years, we were in close games. We lost a handful of games within a touchdown or less. We just couldn't win them. Now we're winning those games. I think the mark of a really good team is closing out, you know, games. And we had opportunity to close out Oklahoma. It didn't happen. But I do think what he's doing and what he's putting on the field defensively, it'll be interesting to see, because we could potentially lose three D linemen. James Lynch, I think he's a first-round talent. Whether he leaves this year or not, if we win that championship, I think he does leave, because he's like, you know, what else can I do?
This is it, man.
But if we don't, you know, win tomorrow, which I 100% think we will, he's going to be like, I got to come back for something else. And he is a pillar, you know, like we talked about earlier, of you know, what you're supposed to do and how you're supposed to do it. But I think Matt Rhule and his staff, you know, I was not a process truster. And I still don't even like the word, because I don't think 1-11 was indicative of us being 1-11-1 this year. However, I always said I wasn't in the locker room. So I don't know what they were doing. I don't know how they were living, how they were working, and how they were competing. Only thing I could see is a product on the game field. And it's just like, none of the stuff ever made sense. It never came together. I'm like, why did we just do that over and over again? I think we're still scratching our heads about some offensive stuff this year.
Right.
But that's why you go to work. I remember, you know, I had Facebook back in the day, and someone asked me how the season going to go. And this was 2009. I said, we're going to win the Big 12 this year. And that's how I felt. And we went to work like we're going to win the Big 12. And there's some people, and you know, Matt Rhule said, when he just has two hands, and all he knows to do is go to work.
Build. He just knows to build.
And so what he's done is he's built a program that these guys love each other. They commit to each other. They play for each other. And they're all on the same page. And regardless of whether I believed in the process or not, that foundation was set with, you know, some of Brown's older guys, mm-hmm. you know, Tyler Young, you know, Taylor Young, and some of those guys that, you know, came in and was like, hey, I'm going to help you set this foundation. So Matt Rhule was able to bridge two totally different, you know, classes in regards to, like, you know, those guys coming in. Denzel Mims is one of those guys as well.
Yep.
And he's been able to be a leader on that offense. And so you think about the magic or the wizard that he is. I think he's built something that is highly sustainable. And I think people are fearing that. And so, you know, people like to talk about rumors. I think he really wants to coach in the NFL. I think that's his passion. If he stays at Baylor for 10 years, you know, Matt Rhule can win the national championship this year. He can go 6-6 next year. And everyone would still, they would talk about, let's erect a statue of him after going 6-6. Baylor Athletics is the best athletic department in the country across all sports, the aggregate. Volleyball is about to be number one in the NCAA tournament. We just won a national championship in basketball. Our big
men's is 18 right now.
Yeah,
I think.
And they're you know, a lot of people's favorite to win the Big 12 this year. Women's and men's tennis are always great. Baseball had a
baseball
great
did
run.
Great. Softball is usually really great.
I mean, last year a soccer team went to, you know, Elite Eight.
We won the Big 12. I think the year before.
Yeah,
tournament. Yeah.
You think about what is going on in Waco. There's a lot of stuff that we just can't see because we're not in the locker room, we're not in the film room, we're not working out with them and behind closed doors. But I think if Matt Rhule stays at Baylor, they will erect a statue of him. And
wow.
What other job you want to have? There's essentially no pressure. Baylor people are going to be happy with winning, you know, going to a bowl game. And even if it's at, you know, Armed Forces Bowl, there's going to be people that come to Fort Worth in December to watch that game. But and anything on top of that is icing on the cake. But I love what he's done this year. I wasn't a process trust, and I still don't like the word, like I said. But what got me to really fall in love with what Matt Rhule was doing at Baylor is after we played Texas last year and we lost at Austin. After the game, he said, "Hey, y'all played great. You don't have to dress up after the game." And instead of the guys not dressing up after the game, he's like, "No, we're gonna do this until we win. You know, we win a game, and until we win the game, and then we can, you know, have a more relaxed fit, you know, going home." And so what that showed me is that he had complete buy-in of all the guys. And as a coach, you can't coach everyone. That's why, you know, a lot of coaches always talk about depth. If you're a senior on a team, like, I don't have to tell a freshman that he needs to protect the ball if he catches the ball and runs down it. Like, you're yelling at him because you understand, like, the importance of it. And so that's, you know, there's coaches on the field. We always hear about that. That's how you build coaches on the field. Like, I should only have to coach one person. Then there's a cascade of events of, like, setting a standard. And this is the standard we work to. If you have piss poor seniors that don't live up to the hype or they don't play competitive football, then your freshmen come in and they make a lot of mistakes. You know, there's a lot of young guys that's, you know, playing big time for us or only 2 years in. They're playing like seniors. You know, John Lovett is, you know, a 3-year running back, and he's playing, you know, the best ball I've seen him play. But it's all because of what Matt Rhule came in and said, we're going to work hard. And you're talking about building confidence? Mm-hmm. Confidence comes from doing something over and over and over again. They hit in practice. They run through plays. They protect the ball. They protect each other. And they have fun. That's the reason why they're 11-1 and playing for a Big 12 championship tomorrow.
Yeah. I guarantee you Matt Rhule, without knowing it, knows his ramp.
Yeah.
He has a good relationship with himself. He has a great relationship with his players. He has great autonomy. He's going to show up. He's going to put his two hands on the line. He's going to go to work. He doesn't need anybody to tell him to do that. He works on mastery. We're gonna hit again. Then we're gonna hit again, and we're gonna do this until we get it right. That's mastery. It's just developing the skill over and over and over again. And he knows why he's doing it. Yeah. He loves what he does. I mean, you can look at him, and you know Matt Rhule loves what he's doing. I think there's something special in Waco for sure.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for coming on. I really do appreciate it, honestly.
Thank you.
It's some semi a fanboying moment for me / professional moment for me. Now that I've been working with athletes, you know, I see you guys as way more than just these TV stars. What I want to leave behind for anybody who's listening or seeing this is TG is a dad. Like, this is what we're trying to emphasize, is he's a person outside of being the Baylor football player.
It's a lot more to life.
A lot more. And if you get nothing else from this, then that's what I want you to get, is that this is TG, the person, not the Baylor football player. If nothing else, that's what I want you to have. Yeah. So thank you so much for coming on, my friend.
Thanks, Chris. Appreciate you.